which is entitled Nothing is Safe, which counts with the presence of Ms. Nicole Carman, the Nobel Peace Prize. I think she is the only Arab woman that won this Nobel Peace Prize. A Yemeni citizen, journalist, activist, politician, and president of Women's Without Chains organization. She was awarded the Nobel Prize in 2011 in recognition of her work in the nonviolent freedom of expression, rights, safety of women, and for women's rights to full participation in peace building work in Yemen. And it is
Yemen was on the path towards building a federal government. Not long had passed since the end of the conference that laid the basis for a new Yemen, which was to guarantee a new, secure, democratic transitional period. However, the Houthi militia and Saleh forces on the 21st of September 2014 toppled these efforts, and all that was rejected by all the segments of society, by the media, by the intelligentsia of Yemen. The aggression by Houthis and Saleh was categorically rejected by the whole world. The Security Council took three resolutions, Resolution 22-1, Resolution 22-4, and Resolution 22-16. All these resolutions confirmed supporting the legal government and the unity and in territorial integrity of Yemen. However, the Houthis and Saleh continued to progress and take control of the governorates and rejecting the legal resolutions of the international community. They undermined all the binding agreements that were reached in the national conference, which led to the appearance of a new rebellion headed by President Abdel Rabbo Hadi. The civil strife alongside the army led to toppling the coup d'etat and the return to what has been approved in the dialogue conference. This led to rejecting war and resorting to a path of peace for rebuilding Yemen. However, this was coincided with the arrival of the Arab coalition headed by Saudi Arabia. The Houthi militias and Saleh forces resorted to besieging all the towns and cities, to shelling them, to hostilities, to planting mines around and inside the cities, particularly the cities from which they were withdrawing. Moreover, there were hundreds and thousands of politicians and writers and those who objected this policy that were found themselves under arbitrary arrest, and most of them continue to be in detention. The freedoms of the citizens and the citizens themselves were subjected to massacres at the hand of the Houthis. This report documents these events, which in this information was collected by our organization, Journalists Without Chains. Moreover, the resolutions of the Arab coalition continues to have collateral damage on the civilians, on the infrastructure, on the institutions, leading to major destruction and death and mayhem. We have carried a study with statistics, and we have been able to refer to cases that were the experts were not able to visit them because of the presence of armed groups and Saleh forces, and because of the sure danger and harm that will befall anyone that will visit these areas. The team of the organization was unable to document major events because of the control of Houthi and Saleh forces. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no secure place in Yemen. The minute we put out the fire in one corner, several other fires spring up in other corners. Destruction is befalling private and public property, and the sacred life of the citizens. I shall now give the floor to our executive director, and then we shall propose and expose our report to you. Thank you.
Powerful, are meaningful, and have to be heard. We cannot give a Nobel Prize of Peace and ignore the voice for peace. I'm very touched by all you have been saying, and I hope everyone around these United Nations and not only will be listening to your very wise words. And now we will have Mrs. Bushra Hassan Al-Suraidi. She's an activist who studied at the College of Mass Communication and Journalism in Sana'a University. She serves as the executive manager of the Women Journalists Without Chain since 2012. Please, the floor is yours.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Allow me at the outset to thank you first without chains regarding the plight of the civilians in our war. Your presence here is testimony to the importance you attach to the situation in Yemen, which found itself in a tunnel without light since 2014. Moreover, the war has not ceased since 18 months. All the institutions have crumbled, the freedoms have been trampled upon, and the political track, which was supposed to lead to a referendum on a new constitution and presidential parliamentary elections, has been stopped. Therefore, our organization has documented all the violations of human rights. We were able to list a huge number of the names of the wounded and the dead as a result of these violations, and the place where the violations took place, whether it was in the street, in the house, in the square, at work, or anywhere, as well as the means of attack. Whether it was shelling as a direct shelling or by plane or through mines or through torture or any mean. The report shows that the majority of these violations, the report is not comprehensive of all the violations that took place, but only the cases that our team was able to reach because of the difficulty of reaching certain directorates, as they were under the control of the Houthis and armed forces, or because of the intensity of hostilities that prevented us from reaching these areas. In this context, I should like to say that we were unable to document the cases of return bullets because this did not allow us to work freely. We were unable to visit hospitals, for example. On the other hand, the report contains a section on journalistic freedoms from January 2015 to June 2016. The result shows that there is a targeting, extinguishing of all the efforts of journalists and their presence. In the future, there will be no journalist in Yemen. This, of course, is a dark reality. We can say that the journalist infrastructure has completely been destroyed. There is no free journalism in Yemen or in the areas under the control of these militias. The journalistic effort normally faces great challenges in war. However, the head of the Houthis in September last considered journalists that they are more dangerous to the country than the armed forces. This led to a great setback to the right of the journalist and increased the intensity of the oppression of the rights of journalists. This report talks about the violations that were dealt to the civilians with various kinds of weapons, as well as the journalists and those who were abducted and forcibly disappeared. In the next March, we will be publishing our next report. We hope by then that Yemen would be enjoying peace in all parts of the country. In conclusion, this war led to deep pain and misery all over our country. This necessitates doubling our efforts to bring the war to an end. These violations will not come to an end unless the war is ended and comes to an end, unless the institutions of the state are back, recovered, and acting normally, and with the control of all the armed forces who practice terrorism under various nominations. In conclusion, I join my prayers to you, hoping that Yemen will soon live in peace. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Surabi. I think that the plight of the journalists, and most in particular the women journalists, really has to be heard by all our nations. I do remember so many journalists, especially women journalists I knew in Iraq, and so many that were murdered, and so many that were so courageous. And this is something that deserves all our efforts and all our dedication. And now, before proceeding with the next speakers, we will have the opportunity of seeing a video on the situation in Yemen. So please, you can go ahead. some technical issue. I would just ask for a bit of patience.
We are proceeding.
So we are proceeding. I'm not sure if we will be able to see some more afterwards, but for the moment, we are proceeding, and the next speaker is, it's Mr. Ibrahim Katabi. So Mr. Ibrahim Katabi is a Yemeni-American political analyst and a human rights advocate and organizer. Thank you very much for coming.
First of all, thank you for having me. Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm going to go ahead and speak in English. What I'm going to talk about today is I'm going to summarize the report and numbers. It is sad to start with saying that nothing is safe in a country like Yemen right now. And the data that I'm going to show next is going to talk about the civilians and the violations or the crimes against civilians in Yemen. So I'm going to walk you through the summary of the report and show you the numbers and how and why and the method was used to target civilians all across the country. Can we move to slide number one? Okay, so it is, this is based on the report, and I want to say before I talk about the numbers is that the report between March 2014 and March 2015. So it's covering only a year of the conflict, and also didn't cover almost everything that happening in the country, but the cases that the team was able to get to. We start here with the conflicting forces. We talk about the death and the injuries. If you look on the far left and the top, these are the crimes that were committed by the Houthi militia, the Saleh troops, what are mainly known in Yemen, the Republican Guards. The total death that was caused by the Houthis and the Saleh troops were 1424. That's crimes against civilians. You can see that against civilians were done by the Houthi and Saleh militia. This is part one. Going to the second party, which is the Arab coalition, you're talking about the total of 1,230 individuals that were killed by strikes. Out of these numbers, 749 men, 169 were women, and 313 were children. Going to the other part of the chart is the injuries, which is 755 men, 130 women, and 237 were children. There is another part where the targets were done. No one knows who did it. Each side claiming that the other side did it. And because the team couldn't go to certain parts of the country, they were able to document these numbers, but also they're showing here, we're talking about the Houthi militia and Saleh troops, along with the Arab coalition. The death numbers in that category is men 92, women 31, and the children 43. The injuries 455 men and 41 women. The other category, which is the unknown, you find death in the streets or different places. You don't know by whom they were killed. The numbers are there. You can see them on the screen. Men 44, women 10, children 11, and the injuries are men 169, women 32, and the children were 54. The totals are actually at the bottom of the chart. The total of men were killed in total, 1,858, women 411, and then children 697. And if you go to the other category where the injuries, that's a lot of people that were that were injured, and many of them up to this point couldn't get medical care or medical attention. Out of the total number, 5,160 men, 794 women, and then 2,145 children. And this is sad to say that all these numbers, and we don't, up to now, we don't have any accountability. Can we move to the next slide? The next slide here shows you the crimes committed by each parties. I mean, you can see the blue colors, and you can see right underneath them, the Houthi and Saleh militia, of course, committed the most crimes against Yemenis. The number is way over 900. The Arab coalition, it's there, so crimes are being committed by both sides. And then you can go down the line, but actually both parties are really committing crimes against Yemenis. Can we move to the third? The third is the injuries that are caused by them, and you can see the percentage. Houthi and Saleh militias, the number is way up there. It's 72% of the total casualties were done by the Houthi and Saleh forces. The Arab coalition, 15%, and I guess because the strikes sometimes target one place, and then most people are killed. So the injuries all across the country, mainly by the Houthi militias. And then the small percentage are in between there. The 9% is where we don't know. We know people being targeted, but there is no confirmation about who did it or who to hold accountable. It is important to say that when the team, when they were recording or conducting the research on the numbers that were done by the Arab coalitions, they didn't, they weren't able to go to places that are controlled by the Houthi and Saleh militias for the reason that, you know, their safety and they could be kidnapped. And so they were able to get information from different groups and from family members and by also taking into account what both sides were saying about when the target was, the individual or the group were killed or injured. Can we move to the other slide? So this slide is very concerning and a big time, given that the numbers of locations that were targeted are mainly residential houses. So we're not talking about the battlefields. We're not talking about military bases. We're not talking about military targets. We're talking about mainly, if you see the number, is 553 of these attacks were done in residential areas and houses. And you know what happened in Taiz, it's under siege, but also were mainly targeted directly by rockets and by tanks by the Houthi and Saleh militia. Also, I'm sure many of you have seen the photos in Aden and Al-Dhali and different places where the main target by the Houthi and Saleh militias were actually the cities, villages, because back then, at that time, there were no Arab coalition on the ground. It was mainly the Houthi and Saleh militias moving in different direction and just trying to take over the country. And as a result, they were just mainly targeting cities and villages. Streets, that's where most, when they were like groups facing each other, a lot of the crimes are done in the streets. And it's sad to see that military bases and crimes that are the war was done mainly inside residential places and cities, which we're not supposed to have. I mean, this is a clear violation of the international law, and maybe even going forward is to come up with a way where military bases and the warehouses of weapons should not be stored and inside cities where they can become military targets. That's the two main ones. The other ones, you can see the crimes occurred in places like marketplaces, detention centers, fuel stations, hospitals, and health centers, bridges and roads, and so forth. And can we go to the next? the this is showing you the targeted location charts, so you can see it really in the numbers. It's like if you look across the board, all you can see the main targets are residential houses and places where civilians mainly live and the streets. So you can't get off your house. When the Houthi and Saleh militia took over Aden, if you leave your house to get water, you can get killed. If you go to the roof, you can get killed. That's when what we mean by the streets. You can't even leave your house. And if you do, as a result, you either will get killed or injured. Can we move to the slide? Here is the death and injuries were also committed by the Arab coalitions. The number is really high there, and is the targets, it's all over. Men were 749, women 169, children 313. That's the death. The injuries are men 755, and then women 130, children 237. So it's completely, the number is really high. And what I wanted to say, out of the 34 cases that were the research was conducted, the data was not completely confirmed, but the team did the reporting on these numbers, and we didn't want these numbers to go unnoticed or people forgot about them down the line. These numbers are there, out in the book, until we got to the bottom of this and got the full confirmation. But these are people and not numbers. I'm sorry to say that they are numbers, but these are human beings, women, children, and men were mainly killed, and they are paying the biggest price in Yemen. Can we move to the, this is the same thing, the death and injuries, if you see, you can see it, all across the board, and this is where done by the Houthi and Saleh militia. There are a few, if you read the report, so this is only the summary of the report. If you go to the report and then read the report, you will be able to get all the details on the cases, the method that they went about getting the research done, and also how they did it. So these are just a summary of what's in the report. There are a few cases that were not confirmed, but the vast majority of the Houthi and Saleh crimes were completely recorded. The names that are in the report, the ages, the locations, and so all these are, for the most part, were confirmed. Can we go to the, I don't know how many minutes I have, but. So this is also some of the numbers where each side is claiming each other, and we don't know who exactly did it, but also there's some that were done clearly by the Houthi and Saleh, and also the Arab coalitions. These are human beings. These are individuals. If you see the numbers, we're talking about the 500 number. People are being killed in the middle of nowhere, and no one knows who killed them. And again, the bottom line, this is, and all this, there is no accountability. Yemeni civilians are the major target in this, and they're the one that paying the heaviest price. If you see on both sides, of course, all of you know that most of them live in fantasy hotels, and the one on Sana'a, like the Houthi and Saleh, militias are hiding. None of their sons were killed. None of their main leaders were killed. So mainly in this war, the civilians are paying the highest price. Here is how the people were either killed or injured, and the percentage are theirs, mainly by heavy armed weapons, life ammunitions, where people are just targeting each other, facing each other. Again, getting off your building or your house and got killed. These are the two major things. It's heavy weapons, rockets, just you sleeping or getting up to eat breakfast, and all of a sudden you got hit by a rocket or by strike. So the main three ones to pay close attention to is like the heavy weapons that were done mainly by the Houthis and Saleh, but also the airstrikes and the life ammunitions, which we're talking about face-to-face fightings, or you got off the street and you got killed. fallen back. The bullets that are usually when you fight on top of a city, they come back, they kill people, and that's another big issue. I wanted to note here that you can see the line mines is still a very small percentage, because we haven't been able, or the team haven't been able to go to a lot of different places to record these violations. But at the same time, I think this is gonna be the biggest problem going forward, because the landmines are over. They put thousands, if not tens of thousands of landmines in the streets, different locations, main roads. And so that's gonna be the biggest issue facing Yemenis into the future. We still haven't, Yemen still haven't been recovered from the landmines that were done in the 70s. There's still people are being killed by those. And now we're talking about a huge percentage of landmines that the Houthi and Saleh militias planted all over the country. And so Yemeni civilians will be the target, and it's gonna be a big problem facing women and children going into the future. Can we go to the next slide? That's the numbers and ratios of casualties and the way how the injuries were, it's the same exact slide as the one before, but you can see the biggest percentage of people killed by either heavy weapons, and that we're talking about rockets, tanks, and heavy weapons and the cities, but also in the same time life ammunition and airstrikes. These are the main big things, how many Yemenis were killed or injured. Can we move into, so this is the, again, it's the way, if you look at the biggest percentage, it's the same thing. No matter what crimes you look at, it's still the big percentage is that weapons used against civilians and civilian areas and streets, and it was mainly done by the Houthi and Saleh forces in the streets and going into cities like Taiz, Aden, Dhala, and all across the country. The other thing that we haven't even been able to go to, like I said, the three main states that a lot of airstrikes were done there, and these are Sada state along with Amran and Hajja. Can I move to the next slide? Is done. I think there was others. Okay, so I can summarize it anyway. I think there's also, snipers were killing people. There were assassinations, direct assassinations. People were kidnapped from the streets. There were all these violations where many of them you can basically can see in the report. I encourage everyone to take the chance to read the report, but these are the numbers that I tried to summarize based on the cases that I were able to get out of the report and make it short and simple. It is sad to say again that nothing is safe. It's sad to come up with a report like that. The Yemenis civilians are paying the biggest price here, and they're not involved in the conflicts. Many of them just inside cities, being a target by one group or the other. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kitabi, for your very comprehensive assessment and actually for the team that really made a remarkable job. I am sure it has been very difficult to do a work like that, but it is a very valuable work. And I think you deserve all the congratulations. We are now trying to go ahead with the film again. Let's see if we are able to.
في لحظة من اللحظات يعني كان في يعني ما يشبه القرار الجماعي انه خلاص هذا النظام السياسي اصبح عاجز عن التطور او بالاصح يعني لا يسمح بحدوث تقدم لحياة المجتمع الناس خرجوا في ثورة الذي ظهر انه الفساد والفشل يعني هذا المأساة التي كانوا الناس عايشين فيها ما كانت الا مظهر بسيط لجبل الجليد الذي ظهر بعد الثورة يعني هذا النظام الذي كان يحكم بمؤسسات تبدو انها فاسدة في الواقع هي كانت مؤسسات مزورة وبالتالي عندما قرر النظام نفسه انه يتحول من نظام الى عصابة ومن حزب الى ميليشيا كانت المسألة بالنسبة له مسألة قليل من الوقت من قبل كنا ننزل كراصدين ويتعاون معنا متعاونين من الميدان وكان لنا مكاتب معروفة وأماكن نتلقى فيها الشكاوى ونرصد فيها ولنا نشاط قانوني مصرح به ولكن كلما مر الوقت وتطورت الأحداث ساءت ظروف العمل أصبحنا الآن يعني كثير من المنظمات التي كانت مراكزها الرئيسية في صنعاء أغلقت أرصدتها في البنوك أوقفت وبالتالي توقفت الأنشطة التي كانت تعمل عليها وأصبح عمليات الرصد يقوم بها ناشطون متطوعون أو وسائل الإعلام الخاصة التي تغطي يوميات الحرب إذا كان الجيش يقدم البلد لغمة سائغة لهذه الميليشيا ويدعي أو يدعو أفراده ومنتسبيه إلى الحياد في وجه ميليشيا تهاجم مؤسسات الدولة وتفرض قرارات على الدولة وتعين هذا وتعزل هذا وتطالب بعزل هذا إذن نحن الآن أمام مرحلة أخرى
لكن أنا متحالف مع أنف الرب بدون أن نتحالف
كانت الميليشيا تتحرك في الطريق من صعدة إلى حجة إلى الجوف عمران وها
أمريكا الموت لإسرائيل اللعنة على اليهود النصر
للإسلام عندما يضع ألغام في بيوت الناس كانت تنفجر بهم عندما يعودون إلى بيوتهم بعد انتهاء الحرب وانتهاء المواجهات ورأينا صور يعني تثير الحزن ويعني تنذر تعز بشكل خاص حوصرت منع الناس من الحصول على المواد الغذائية تعرضوا للإذلال تعرضوا للإهانة المستشفيات قطعت عنها الأدوية أو لإجراء عملية شاهدنا الناس وهم يحاولون أن يفكوا هذا الحصار ويوصلوا المواد الغذائية والأكسجين إلى المستشفيات على ظهورهم في طرق وعرة وعلى ظهور الحمير عندما يكتشف الإنسان أن الحمار أصبح أكثر إنسانية من بعض الناس كانت مواقف صادمة ومؤثرة كيف أصبحت توجد في أماكن أخرى خطرة ويصبح هؤلاء الأطفال ضحايا ما بين قتلى وأسرى وجرحى. في الواقع الميليشيا لا تنكر تجنيد الأطفال، بل تضع صور الأطفال الذين قتلوا وهم يقاتلون في صفوفها